Thermodynamic boundary layers develop because of the difference between the free stream velocity and the zero velocity on a plate. Thermal boundary layers develop because of the difference between the surface temperature of this plate and the free stream temperature. The differential equations that govern two-dimensional boundary layer flow can be simplified, and the resulting equations can be used for many of the dimensionless parameters that govern convective heat transfer. In order to use the differential equations that we have to have the following conditions. First of all, body forces, in particular gravity, are considered to be negligible. In addition, there is no thermal generation. The flow is laminar, and gradients normal to the object's surface are much larger than those along the surface. And what comes out of that is that d squared t dx squared is very much less than d squared t dy squared. This is true for boundary layers since the boundary layer thickness is very small compared to its surface, and the velocities and temperature in the x direction must change over these very small distances. In addition, we can assume that the pressure in the x direction can be approximated by the free stream pressure. And that has more to do with momentum boundary layer equations rather than thermal boundary equations. So the technique to non-dimensionalize the momentum equation was shown in a previous screencast. Here, we're going to non-dimensionalize the energy equation that was derived from analysis of control volume. And so what we have after that analysis is that u, which is the velocity in the x direction, dt dx plus v, the velocity in the y direction, dt dy, is equal to alpha, which is the thermal diffusivity, d squared t dy squared. Now, normally you would have a d squared t dx squared, but because of the boundary layer assumptions, that goes to zero. Plus the kinematic viscosity over the heat capacity du divided by dy squared. And this last term is considered the thermal dissipation, and we assume that this is negligible relative to the terms on the left-hand side, which govern advection, and the first term on the right-hand side, which is conduction. So now we're left with a differential equation that looks like that. So we'll look at the simplest case. Laminar flow over a parallel plate will non-dimensionalize the variables and put these equations in a form that will result in the governing dimensionless variable for convective heat transfer. So let's see the variables that we're going to need to non-dimensionalize. So we have this u, v, x, y, and t. And the way we non-dimensionalize or normalize these variables is to use a characteristic velocity or a characteristic length or some kind of temperature expression to make these non-dimensional. So for both u and v, what we're going to do is divide it by this free stream velocity. For x and y, we're going to divide it by the characteristic length, in this case, the length of the plate. The most difficult one is temperature. And so when we find a non-dimensionless temperature, which is anytime you have that star, it means that it's non-dimensional. We're going to define this as equal to t minus ts divided by t infinity minus ts. And so the other ones, non-dimensionalize them such that u star is equal to our u divided by that u infinity. V star is the same. And again, remember that's in the y direction. Our x star is just going to be x divided by l. And finally, our y star is y divided by l. And so next we need to rewrite our original variables in terms of our dimensionless ones. And this is how they'll look. Continuing, we can find that dx dx star, so if we look at that first one, is just going to be equal to l. Therefore, we can replace dx with l dx star. We can do the same thing with dy. A more difficult one is the temperature. So we find that dt, dt star, and we have to go back to this, is just equal to t infinity minus ts. And therefore, we can replace dt with t infinity minus ts times dt star. So now let's look at some of the things that we have to replace in our original equation. So one of the terms was dt dy, and if we write them in terms of our expressions above, and we do the exact same thing for dt dx. Now we look at that second derivative term. So that's just d dy of dt dy, which is equal to 1 over our l dy star. And then our dt dy is t infinity minus ts divided by l d squared t star over dy star. And this entire thing ends up being. And so now let's go back to the original equation that we're looking at. And what we're going to do here is we're going to replace our u with our expression with u star, our dt dx, our v, and everything here we're going to replace with the expressions that we developed below in terms of the t star, x star, etc. And if you notice, there's quite a few common terms here. And so what we're going to do is we're going to divide each expression by u infinity, t infinity, minus ts, divided by l. And when we do this, this is what we're left with. And although you can tell that we've simplified it, the question is, what do we do with this particular expression here? And what we can do is rewrite this such that our kinematic viscosity divided by u infinity times l times alpha over that kinematic viscosity, which is equal to that expression, is actually equal to 1 over the Reynolds number, and because we're dealing with a flat plate, that's sub L, times the Prandtl number. So how does this help? Well, let's take a look, and we'll go back to when we first defined in the thermal boundary layer, our convective heat transfer coefficient. So now what we're going to look at is that Y star equals zero, H, and here's our Newton's law of cooling, TS minus T infinity is equal to minus thermal conductivity of the fluid. Now dT dy at y star equals zero. And now what we can do is replace that dT dy with our dT star dy star. And this is going to be equal to, again, our case of F. Notice the sign has changed over L, dT star dy star at y star equals zero. And what we now do is define what's known as the Nissel number, which is H times L divided by K of the fluid, and that's going to be equal to this expression. And so what that means is for a prescribed geometry, our Nissel number is just going to be a function of X star, the Reynolds number, and the Prandtl number. And this is analogous to that friction coefficient at Y equals zero in the hydrodynamic boundary layer. If now we're looking for an average or all over the length of the plate, we have that our average Nissel number, it's now independent of spatial, and so it's equal to only a function of this Reynolds number and Prandtl number. And what's important to us is that all of our correlations for all of our geometries for the Nissel number and therefore the convective heat transfer are of this form, a function of the Reynolds number and the Prandtl number. So you can get something simple like this one, where all you need to know is the Reynolds number and the geometry. Look up your C and your M, which are constants, find the Nissel number, and then find our convective heat transfer coefficient. And the reason we want that convective heat transfer coefficient is because we want to use Newton's law of cooling for convection, which is just H times our delta T. We also have some that are a little bit more complex, where here we have a Nissel number for a sphere in cross flow. However, if you notice, both of them are a function of the Reynolds number and the Prandtl number, and that's what you'll find when you're doing all of your forced convection problems. The important part of the analysis is to determine which function of the Reynolds number and the Prandtl number you should use. Finally, I just want to go back and mention in all of the derivations that I did, I said like dt, dy, or dt, dx. These are partial differential equations. So technically, it should have been del t, del x.